Despite its name, power pop as a genre has often failed to accrue the popularity necessary to set the charts ablaze. Fountains of Wayne's brand of detail-rich storytelling and bittersweet character study, twinned with a sugary 90s alt-rock crunch, did little to change that. They were the bizarro Weezer, loved by critics, but underrated by the general music-listening public. That was until they created the second-catchiest song ever written about a girlfriend's parent. By that point, though, one of their songwriters had already racked up his fair share of fantasy pop gems for Hollywood. This is the story of Stacy's mum and the many imaginary hits of Adam Schlesinger. The two core members of Fountains of Wayne, Chris Collingwood and Adam Schlesinger, met in 1986 while studying at Williams College in Massachusetts. Collingwood approached Schlesinger while he was playing an REM song on guitar to tell him he was playing the wrong chords. Soon they would form various groups together, writing primitive impersonations of their heroes: REM The Replacements, Elvis Costello The Beatles, Beach Boys and Harry Nilsson. Collingwood and Schlesinger would gain a record deal with their early group Pinwheel in 1993, but were inevitably screwed by the label. Tired of trying to make music their career, they went their separate ways and tried to make it in the white-collar working world. Sometime later in 1995, inspiration hit Collingwood, who pumped out a trilogy of melodic, softly fuzzy tunes. Radiation Vibe. Joe Ray. And Leave the Biker.
Baby, please, leave the biker, leave the biker, break his heart.
And contacted his old writing partner. Radiation Vibe caught Schlesinger's ear.
Don't it make you wanna get some sun? Shine on, shine on, shine on.
He just wrote it as a goof, but I was like, man, that's a great song. I don't know what it is about that song, but it's got some kind of magic, fun quality to it that we never really had in anything before. I got very jealous of that song.
After they'd split, Schlesinger had formed dream pop trio Ivy, but quickly wrote Sink to the Bottom in response to Collingwood's song, and with the intent of reforming their partnership.
I wanna sink to the bottom with you.
Meeting up at a bar in New York, the pair would drunkenly make up humorous song titles, and then go home and attempt to make them reality, resulting in She's Got a Problem.
She's got a problem.
And Please Don't Rock Me Tonight.
Please don't rock me tonight, I'm not in
the mood. As jokey as the titles might have been, the songs themselves are like mini short stories, imbued with a sense of compassion and melancholy for the characters in the song. The band rarely wrote from an autobiographical perspective. Soon they would write enough of these silly yet sad story songs to form an album. From Collingwood's ode to his wife and her contempt for Oasis on Barbara H.
All day, the radio's been playing the same song.
To Schlesinger depicting a young secretary sleepwalking her way through her day at work on sick day.
And she's making the scene with the coffee and cream.
Especially on this song, Schlesinger would show his talent for subtle detail. In his descriptions of her commute to an office-based purgatory.
Check out the girl in the harbor tunnel. Greet us not into Penn Station till the bath train finally comes.
When you're writing pop music, details are important because they're what make the song come to life. You have to put images in there that give you some kind of mental picture of what's happening.
She's alone in the
If you try to keep everything general and grand, then the song tends to come across as lifeless. That's how we end up with a lot of little scenes that people zoom in on.
The band cut a demo and managed to get a deal with Atlantic in the post-Weezer label signing spree. With help from bassist Danny Weinkoff, they would record their debut album in less than a week. Prior to this, Adam and I had both been careful, serious songwriters, in the vein of Simon and Garfunkel. We were much more careful about the arrangements and everything. But when we decided to make this record quickly and spontaneously, we figured that since doing it so fast was such a stupid idea, the band needed a stupid name as well. Fountains of Wayne was a name that Schlesinger's mother had suggested years previous, from a lawn ornament store based in Wayne, New Jersey, not too far away from where Schlesinger grew up. Released in October 1996, their self-titled debut and their first modern rock hit, Radiation Vibe, stood in stark contrast with the post-grunge and new metal bands that were starting to emerge. They were a pop band in the conventional sense, like the Beatles or Beach Boys, but with added low-key alt-rock distortion and third-person lyrics about losers, misfits, and sad sacks. He's got his arm around every man's dream, crumbs in his beard from the seafood special. Grunge music is taking the emphasis completely away from melody and songwriting, things sorely needed in music right now. Fortunately, some bands are going back to melody and harmony, and they're getting attention now because people are just sick of grunge. Their debut album did not set the world on fire. Released a week after Weezer's Pinkerton, critics were betting it would fill the blue-flavored hole in their fanbase's soul. But Radiation Vibe's bizarre Twilight Zone-themed video didn't have the same good time appeal as Buddy Holly or The Sweater Song, and so didn't get the essential MTV push. They toured the world supporting the likes of The Smashing Pumpkins, Lemonheads, and Sloan, but they remained a cult band. But that didn't stop Schlesinger from creating his first fictional top 10 hit. In 1995, Schlesinger responded to an open call for songwriters to write a song for Tom Hanks' directorial film debut called That Thing You Do. Set in 1964, the film is about a garage band called The Wonders that had an unexpected single shoot right up the Billboard chart, the eponymous That Thing You Do. The assignment was to write that one hit.
The obvious reference for the time period they were talking about was the Beatles, but as part of the instructions for it, it said that, you know, we'd rather have it sound like an American band that's, you know, kind of a cheap imitation of the Beatles, you know, because there were a lot of bands sprouting up then.
The Knickerbockers.
Yeah, that kind of stuff, you know, trying to capitalize on what the Beatles had done. So that's what I was going for.
As Schlesinger had spent his 20s ripping off the Beatles, this seemed perfectly suited to his talents. So he tossed something off in a couple of days, not thinking too much about it.
They had the title before I even started writing the song. In fact, one of my first questions was, "That thing you do? What does that mean?" I don't think anyone had a specific idea of what that meant.
Almost a parody of 1960s British Invasion era pop music, That Thing You Do feels like a beloved but lost one-hit wonder from 1964. You, doing that thing you do. Schlesinger took all the elements that made that era of the Beatles so damn catchy, the super sweet harmonies. Hurts me so just to see you go around with someone new. The refreshing jangle. The heart-racing tempo. As well as a deft touch with a minor chord. Breaking my heart into a million pieces. And condensed it down to 170 seconds of weapons-grade power pop. Every time you do that thing you do. It even has a Paul McCartney-style exclamation before the solo. He would submit the demo of the song under the non-existent band name, Scientist Alexis, performed by himself, sung by Mike Viola of the Candy Butchers, and with Andy Chase of Ivy on drums.
Tom Hanks had the confidence in his own taste to say, "I want to use this song." The fact that he was willing to take this song from some unknown guy was unbelievable.
The film That Thing You Do would be released on the first week of October 1996, the same as Fountains of Wayne's debut. It too was initially a modest success, before picking up a bigger audience via VHS rentals and showings on basic cable. But listeners couldn't get enough of that song. Featured approximately 11 separate times in the film, earworming its way into the viewer's very id, it soon generated its fair share of real-life radio airplay, becoming Schlesinger's first tune to hit Billboard, reaching number 41 on the Hot 100. It would also be nominated for a Golden Globe and an Academy Award for Best Original Song, losing out both times to Andrew Lloyd Webber and Tim Rice for You Must Love Me from Evita.
I was up against Andrew Lloyd Webber and Diane Warren. You know, all my peers, basically. It was funny because Diane Warren was sitting right in front of me, and she writes these really sappy love ballads. I'm everything I am because you love me. How do I live without you? 'Cause I miss you, baby, and I don't wanna miss a thing. But her personality does not fit her music. When he won, she was like, that piece of won?
The song's success, though, would open up a parallel career for Schlesinger, a go-to songwriter for Hollywood's alternative reality smashes. Fountains of Wayne only became a workable band after the release of their debut, because the ensuing tour necessitated such. Collingwood, as well as assuming lead vocals, would play guitar. Schlesinger would take up bass alongside harmonies, joined by Jody Porter on lead guitar, and Brian Young of the Posies on drums. 3 years later, in 1999, Utopia Parkway would hit shelves. Although all their songs are credited as Collingwood Schlesinger, after their first album, the pair rarely wrote together, both having their own process, with only the most devoted fans being aware of who wrote what.
A lot of times, my songs are a little more narrative and literal, easier to follow as a story. Chris tends to write a little more impressionistic kind of stuff.
While Collingwood had written the majority of the songs on their first album, their second was a 50-50 split. Once again, they wrote bittersweet tales of failures and also-rans. From the dud who believes getting some ink will improve his romantic prospects on Red Dragon Tattoo. To It Must Be Summer's Bird's Year in Account, a romantic loss and seasonal affective disorder. Upon release in April 1999, critics were falling over themselves to compare Utopia Parkway to the similarly detail-rich kitchen sink dramas featured on Muswell Hillbillies by the Kinks. I'm just and Born to Run by Bruce Springsteen. As per the latter, their title track's starry-eyed protagonist dreams of an escape from Nowheresville. Well, I've been saving for a custom van. Though with ambitions comically falling short of the boss. It also takes a mirror to Fountains of Wayne themselves, and their flailing endeavors to rock and roll into their 30s. And my baby doesn't understand
why I never turned from boy to man. It's kind of making fun of myself, you know, the absurdity of what we do in a way. But, you know, he's talking about the idea that he's going to take over the town. He's going to make it into New York and conquer the big city.
Though the music press were in love with the record, it didn't sell. Instead, their more in vogue label mates like Matchbox 20 or Kid Rock were getting the radio play. Fountains of Wayne's idiosyncratic pop singles with sometimes purposely awkward lyrics. She works at Liberty Travel. She got a hot bit of gravel. Struggled to find a wide audience.
But the funny thing about playing pop music is, that's what the original intention of pop music was. It wasn't supposed to be this little cultish thing, it's supposed to be songs that sound great blasting out of a car radio. And just through a funny turn of events, the kind of pop we make is now seen as some kind of fringe alternative thing.
It even got to the point where the label was proposing the band release their modern rock cover of Britney Spears' Baby One More Time as a single.
Hit me, baby, one more time.
in an attempt to get some radio interest, a move that the band were very much against. I was like, what? We wrote a bunch of songs. What about those? Literally any other band in the world could have recorded that Britney Spears song. Then some other bands did. Probably had the same fight with their label. Around the end of 2000, after uninspired sales and label indifference, Fountains of Wayne would be dropped by Atlantic, leaving the band's future uncertain. Concurrently, Schlesinger was living his other life, writing alternative reality megahits, this time for the 2001 film Josie and the Pussycats. At that time, Adam was starting to take on projects that had nothing to do with us, something that would continue from then on. We could always hear him talking to some asshole about the bumper not being upbeat enough and such. Presumably music for some business purpose. We teased him about it, but he was getting paid. Based on the Archie's comic of the same name, Josie and the Pussycats was again the story of a garage band that through happenstance and one solidly catchy tune climbed the charts. More so than That Thing You Do, it was a satire on the music machine and the soullessness of modern pop, painted in bubblegum pastel hues. And again, Schlesinger was employed to write that chart-climbing tune.
That was actually a fun project because there were a lot of really cool people involved. Matthew Sweet and Kay Handley from Letters to Cleo, who is the voice of Josie, and Jane Wiedlin wrote some stuff, so there was actually some very good music.
Pretend to Be Nice was this film's That Thing You Do, a solely Schlesinger endeavor. Just pretend to be nice. Can you at least pretend to be nice? The directors had wanted an all-female Blink-182, and this song detailing a less than worthy suitor delivers that. What do you do, what you do to me, baby? Shaking my confidence, driving me crazy. But with more hooks than the best of Cheap Trick. It comes across as a reply to the Blink song Josie, her response being that everything is very much not gonna be fine. Yeah, my girlfriend takes me home and I'm too drunk to drive. She's driving me right out my front door. She laughs at my dumb jokes when no one does. I try to tell a joke, he's heard it before. I show up. Schlesinger is also one of the 10 writers on Patchwork Power Pop Pastiche, Come On. Come on, come on, come on, come on, come on. Working with a dream team of melody-minded 90s alternative rock songwriters, which as well as the previously mentioned, included Adam Duritz of Counting Crows, Anna Veronka from That Dog, and Jason Faulkner from Jellyfish. It was an opportunity to play as mainstream as possible without a shot to their indie cred.
A lot of people on this record were all in these power pop bands that were sort of not quite mainstream acts. It's such a pleasure for everybody to write for something like this that's really straight ahead, in your face pop music, and know it's going to be in a movie. You're suddenly not this weird left of center power pop category, you're swinging for the fence with it.
Unfortunately, the film itself did not do well at the box office, not even making its budget back. However, through its ultra-infectious soundtrack and quietly subversive message, it has since become a well-regarded cult classic. But having written two solid gold make-believe hits, it was time that Schlesinger wrote a hugely successful song for his own band. Without a label, it would take until 2003 for the band to record and release their third album, Welcome Interstate Managers. Similar to how Jimmy World, after being dropped by Capitol, would self-fund Bleed American in the hopes they would get a new deal, the same was true for Fountains of Wayne. Shopping for labels in the interim, they would get the same response from A&R people. You guys are great, definitely something I would listen to, but I can't sell this to radio. The whole experience was having a detrimental effect on the band's hopes for the future.
I think Chris felt especially bummed during that whole period. He just sort of felt like we worked for a really long time and it didn't add up to anything. And it didn't seem like the future had much in the way of promise.
Once the album was done, they worked a deal with S-Curve, a new label formed by the guy who'd previously signed them to Atlantic. While the album featured the usual distinctive narratives, binge drinking salesman,
seven scotch and sodas at the office party, now I don't remember where I'm from,
superstar crushes,
now I see your face in the strangest places, movies and magazines,
and chronically slow waitresses.
It's like she's been
a song about fancying your girlfriend's mother stood out as Fountains of Wayne's best chance for a hit, and Mrs. Robinson for the MSN generation.
Mrs. Robinson, Jesus loves you more than you will know.
The initial kernel of an idea for Stacy's mum was Schlesinger's memory of a school friend who, having hit puberty earlier than his peers, armed with a bad teenage mustache, slight height advantage, and delusions of grandeur, thought he would be able to pull Schlesinger's grandmother.
One of my best friends, when we were maybe 11 or 12, came to me and announced that he thought my grandmother was hot, and I said, hey, you're stepping over the line. But at that point in life, I wouldn't put it past anyone.
Stacy's mom has got it going on. She's all I want.
As much as it is a comic song, with a truly delusional protagonist. There are still those trademark Fountains of Wayne elements of pathos and detailed imagery. How many times have we read way too much into simple statements from a desired one?
I could tell she liked me from the way she stared and the way she said, you missed a spot over there.
Musically, the song was formed in a similar way to Schlesinger's genre pastiche film songs. But instead of imitation Beatles rock and roll, or all-female Blink-182 punk pop, it lent towards the new wave pop rock of the Cars. That reference point was genius, as the Cars had their own collection of cool, aloof songs about pining for an unavailable love interest. Whether that be on the icy ballad, Drive.
Who's gonna drive you home tonight?
Or the more hand-clap-centric, My Best Friend's Girl. The most obvious steal from the Boston band is Stacy's mum's introduction. A palm-muted stutter with abrupt guitar explosions, so similar to Just What I Needed. That Cars songwriter, Rick Ocasek, thought it was a sample. But the hand claps, the synths, and the hiccuping, yet oh-so-chilled vocal delivery in the verses.
It's a reaction to love, is she there, or is she trying to give me the slip?
Are all vital details in getting the homage note perfect. The lead-up to the chorus, though, is absolutely a pull from Rick Springfield's Jesse's Girl. When the song was presented to Collingwood, from the first listen, he could foresee what the single would do to the band. No longer a critically adored cult band, but a Bloodhound Gang level punchline. I tried to talk him out of Stacy's mum. I could see exactly what was going to happen. And when it started happening in slow motion, it just felt inevitable. He was too good a writer to have that be his calling card. And the success of a novelty song means that's just what you are to the public. From that moment on, forever. What secured the hit status of Stacy's mum was its music video. Just like how the song was not low-key in its appreciation for hot mothers, the video took a similar tact.
Yeah, we didn't really hold back at all. We looked at a lot of treatments, and some directors were trying to be kind of arty and subtle with it, but Chris Applebaum went completely for the jugular.
The clip also drives home the Cars homage. Not only with the Rick Ocasek looking kid at the bus stop and the I Heart Rick vanity plate, but also a Phoebe Cates from Fast Times at Ridgemont High illusion. The original scene, soundtracked by the Cars, moving in stereo. The band even wanted model Polina Poroskova as their first choice, Ocasek's then wife. Rachel Hunter, though, was an iconic replacement.
We somehow convinced Rachel Hunter to star in our video, which is a very good thing. She was a fan, she liked the song and the band, and she thought it was a good idea, and who are we to say no? She was absolutely perfect for it, she totally got the song and did the video in the right spirit.
Stacy's Mum was released in May 2003, going top 20 in the UK, Ireland and Australia, and was Schlesinger's first non-fantasy song to infiltrate the Billboard Hot 100, making its way to number 21. The song, the video, and its surrounding attention got the band nominated for a Grammy, confusingly, for Best New Act. After over a decade in the music industry, Fountains of Wayne finally had a song that people knew and could hum. In a way, it made the band, but in others, it destroyed them. Fountains of Wayne follow up Stacy's Mum with Mexican Wine. Schlesinger's attempt to write a more impressionistic song in Collingwood's usual mode. Despite its expensive video, with an exponential increase of bikini-clad models, it didn't chart. For better or worse, they had become the Wonders with their one hit. Collingwood, who had kickstarted the band back in 1995, found it hard to continue with Fountains of Wayne. After battling depression and alcoholism, he was only able to muster 3 songs for 2007's Traffic and Weather. He was dismissive of the fleeting popularity they'd found with Stacy's Mum, and so no longer felt like writing jokier material like his Leave the Biker or Red Dragon Tattoo anymore.
Some of the early records, I was still writing kind of goofy songs, and I grew up and I'm in my mid-40s now. It's not something that interests me anymore to make people chuckle with music.
The working relationship between Collingwood and Schlesinger was also deteriorating. Collingwood's interest was aimed at his other, more country-based project, The Gay Potatoes, while Schlesinger's main thing was now writing songs for other people. The majority of the songs for the 2007 Hugh Grant Drew Barrymore rom-com, music and lyrics, was written by Schlesinger. Another opportunity to write some fake hits, including the toxic-esque Buddha's Delight. And the film's narrative heart, Way Back Into Love.
All I wanna do is find a way back into love.
You have to take those assignments seriously and get into the world of the movie. In fact, when I'm writing a Fountains of Wayne song, I think to myself, okay, what would those Fountains of Wayne guys write?
While the band never officially broke up, after their 2011 album Sky Full of Holes, they felt no motivation to continue on. I like Skyfall of Holes quite a lot, but it was no fun to make. There were 2 different writers with 2 increasingly different visions, and we spent more time fighting than recording. I try never to say never, but it's staggering to think of everything that would have to happen for me to want to repeat that experience. While Collingwood would re-find his creative mojo, working on the straight-faced 60s pop arrangements of Look Park. Schlesinger would move further into comedy songs, not only composing for Stephen Colbert's Christmas special.
Take it from Stephen, there are much worse things to believe in.
And the opening songs for the 2011 Billboard Music and Tony Awards.
Everybody loves music, it feels so good in your brain.
Attention every breeder, you're invited to the theater. It's not just for gays anymore.
But most extensively as executive music producer on Rachel Bloom's CW musical sitcom Crazy Ex-Girlfriend from 2015 to 19. taking his genre mimicry to its ultimate form. For this show, he would help form the breathy Monroe parody, The Math of Love Triangles.
This triangle's scaling.
That's astute, so I need to decide which man's more acute.
The Piano Man send-up, What'll It Be?
Is my purpose in life to slice limes with a knife, or to serve Deb a vodka and cranberry juice?
Hey Deb, I'll be right with you.
And the show's central thematic piece, the self-hating Bernadette Peters-style diva ballad, You Stupid Bitch.
You're just a lying little bitch who ruins things and wants the world to burn.
To name just three. Over four seasons, Crazy Ex-Girlfriend featured over 150 original songs, which alongside Bloom and Jack Dolgan, Schlesinger had been involved as either a writer, producer, or arranger. It was what his career had been building to, with a future in Broadway just around the corner. His work on Sarah Silverman's The Bedwetter musical memoir already complete. Adam Schlesinger died on the 1st of April 2020, suddenly from COVID-19. He was 52. In 2011, a journalist asked Fountains of Wayne if they'd come to terms with Stacy's mum being mentioned in the first sentence of their obituary. Such was its overwhelming shadow over their careers. Schlesinger replied,
I think the headline of my obit is going to be that thing he did.
But when the death notices did come in, Stacy's mum was a footnote, perhaps the thing the public knew best. But for his fans and the critics that had championed his work throughout, they'd rather celebrate the diversity of his talent. The greatest tribute was the charity compilation, Saving for a Custom Van, featuring renditions of his songs from the many artists he'd worked with or inspired.
Please don't rock me tonight, I'm not in the mood.
All I wanna do is find a way back into love. And she's making the scene with the coffee and cream.
Every time you do that thing you do,
baby, can't you see? Stacy's mom has got it going on.
He wrote silly yet sad songs about losers and burnouts, but also note-perfect pastiches of classic pop, make-believe chart smashes, and comedy songs about underlying mental health issues. Simply, there was not just one thing that Adam Schlesinger did. Thanks for watching. So what's your favorite song that Adam wrote? Let me know by commenting down below. If you like this video, like, subscribe, and why don't you also do me a favor and share it with a couple of people? It really does help. Thanks to Mike the Snare for voicing Adam Schlesinger. Again, if you like my channel, you'll love his. His deep dives on Chumbawamba and Queen are greatly recommended. I'd also like to shout out all my supporters over on Patreon. Thank you so very, very much. And I'll see you in 2 weeks' time for something intelligent and danceable.